Great to see everyone out in this chilly evening. I'm glad you're here. Our scripture reading for today comes from John chapter 19, verses 17 and 18. It says, carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. Here they crucified him and with him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Just about everywhere you go, you can see a cross in some shape or form. Virtually every place that sells any kind of jewelry, they'll have a necklace or something that has a cross on it. Maybe they'll just be pins, but whatever, you can see crosses in many different environments. And if you were to ask the average American about what the cross might mean, they would probably say it's a symbol of Christianity. Which, that's not 100% wrong. Some of them, if you'd say, well, what would you say happened at the cross? Some of them would tell you, well, Jesus was crucified there. Others might tell you they don't know. And others might deny that the events at the cross even happened, because many people say it didn't. So it's hard to tell what kind of answer you would get. While many people connect the cross with Christianity, they don't always understand it. So the first thing we want to ask, what is the cross? I mean, it seems like a silly question to ask a room full of Christians who've been raised studying the Bible and understand what the cross is, but what is the cross? Well, first, the cross symbolizes shame. The cross was considered a shameful instrument of death because only the vilest of criminals were crucified. This wasn't something that happened just to any old criminal. Only the ones they considered the worst parts of society, only the ones they thought were the worst people ever to live, those were the people that were put on the cross. And so when we think of Jesus being put on the cross between these two criminals, you can imagine what these two criminals must have done in their life. What kind of people they must have been, because they are being crucified, because that is a cruel, cruel form of death. And of course, the Jews considered anyone who was crucified as cursed. And that came from, well, of course, you look at Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13. For it's written, cursed is anyone who is hung on a tree. And that comes from Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 23. So it wasn't something they made up. It was something that came from God. Anyone that hung on a tree was cursed. And now the cross, the tree, this is where Jesus died. So that is why it is an emblem of shame and suffering. Because it is an emblem of a cruel death by someone who probably deserved death. Secondly, the cross was an instrument of torture. I mean, you think about the cross, what it did. One could be tied to the cross or nailed to the cross. Jesus, of course, was nailed. That's what the scriptures tell us. And Jesus was nailed to the cross. Now, imagine, if you will, the cross being laid flat on the ground and Jesus being laid on it and his arms being stretched out and then the nails being driven through his hands. You've already started the torture before anything else. And of course, in Jesus' case, he had already been beaten until his back was raw. They put a robe on him. Then they ripped it off. Imagine what that felt like. And now all that raw flesh is against that hard wood, because I'm pretty sure it wasn't nice, smooth, and finished like this. And so now you have Jesus on there with that raw back, getting the nails pounded through his hands and his feet. And of course, the method of death on the cross is suffocation. And that's a painful way to die, when you can't breathe, you can't get your breath. And then if one on the cross didn't die soon enough, well, what'd they do? They broke their legs. so they could no longer lift themselves up in order to try to catch a breath. When they came to Jesus, of course, he was already dead. And so John tells us in John chapter 19 and verse 34, instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. And so Jesus had already suffocated by the time they come to check on him. But this way of death is weak, is they were cruel and unusual. But to them, if you was a violent, vile criminal, this was a justified way to die. And so the cross was that symbol of shame. It was an instrument of torture, but it also is a reminder. The cross is a reminder for us. I mean, think about it. What do you think of when you see the cross? You know, several years ago, there was a gentleman who went across the country placing three crosses along highways. And when they asked him why he did it, he said, "I want to remind people of what happened on the cross. I want people to see that and be reminded of what Jesus did for them. And for maybe those who don't know Jesus, it might bring them to question, what are those about? So somebody will have the opportunity to present the gospel to them, to be able to tell them what the cross was all about. But for Christians, when we see a cross, the first thing we should remember was the fact that Jesus died on that cross for us. That he bled and died there for us. His blood was shed there to take away our sins. And it should be a reminder to us, to help us to live in such a way that we live to glorify him. And of course, it should also remind us of God's love. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8 says that God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. You think about that. God loved us so much that he sent his one and only perfect son to die on this instrument of torture, this symbol of shame, so that we, as Paul put it, who were still sinners, would be saved. You know, he didn't look at the world and say, look at those people. Look at the mess they're in. They don't know straight up. Now, he looked at the world and said, that's my creation that I love. They're created in my image. And I want to spend eternity with them. So I'm going to give them a pathway that they can be saved. Actually, he decided that before the creation of the world. And he sent Jesus to the cross so that we might be saved. While we were still sinners. So that should be a great reminder of just how much we are loved and how deep that love that God has for us is. So what happened at the cross? Well, Jesus took away the old law, for one. The cross signaled the end of the old law and was ushering in the period of grace. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 14 says, having canceled the written code with its regulation that was against us and that stood opposed to us, he took it away, nailing it to the cross. Now, the way Paul worded this, you might think, well, the code, it was against us with its regulations. It wasn't that the law was bad. If you go back and you look at Romans chapter 7, Paul explains the law wasn't bad, but what the law did, it just revealed what sin actually was. It told us what sin was. He said, if the law would not have said, do not covet, I wouldn't want to covet. But it kind of, you know, human nature, tell me not to do something, I'm going to do it. But he said, the law revealed what sin was. And the law was difficult. It was difficult to keep. By the time Jesus walked the earth, there were so many rules and regulations within the law, nobody could keep it. Nobody. There was, around 360-some laws that was in effect by the time Jesus walked the earth. And they had to try to keep them all. And it couldn't be done. So Jesus took that law and he nailed it to the cross. Because the law had a purpose. Yeah, it revealed sin, but it was to introduce the world to Jesus. The Jews were supposed to see, be able to look at that law and see that there was a Messiah coming. There was a Savior coming. It was to help them to learn how to live in a righteous way. So that when Jesus came, they'd be ready. Not all of them saw it. Not all of them learned from it. But many things happened that day when Jesus hung on the cross besides his death. We see darkness in the middle of the day. We saw an earthquake. Graves were opened and many of the righteous that had died walked again. And then the veil in the temple was torn. And of course, that signaled the separation, or the end of separation. Everybody would be united, because it was the veil that stood between the regular part of the temple and the Holy of Holies. And it signaled to the point you no longer had to have a priest, that everybody was welcome into the presence of God. But those were the things that happened as Jesus died on the cross. Now, I don't know about you, but some of those things going on, you would have thought it would have woke people up. When it gets dark in the middle of the day, there's an earthquake. Maybe they thought the world was ending. In reality, it was just the beginning. The beginning of something great. The beginning of something new. Here on the cross, the grace of God was introduced. God did not have to send Jesus to die for us. That was his choice. He chose to do that because he loved us. Moses had brought the law to the people. Jesus brought grace. He came and fulfilled the law and the prophets. Everything that was said about him was true. So again, the people should have seen, this is the man. This is what Isaiah had said. He would be born in Bethlehem. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. He would be born of a virgin. Jesus was born of a virgin. I mean, think of those two things by himself. You think that would have had some impact. You know, the people that might have heard Isaiah prophesy and are thinking, why in the world would anything happen in Bethlehem? Right? It's just a small little bird. Why would anything go on there? Why would something so great come out of there? Because that was God's plan. And that's what the prophet said. And so Jesus was born. He came to earth. He brought grace on the cross. He tried to get people to understand what grace was before he died. And then this brings it into effect. And salvation by grace became the order of the day. In Romans chapter 6 and verse 14, Paul said, "For sin shall not be your master, because you are not under law, but under grace." You know, we know, according to what Paul also says in Ephesians, we are saved by grace through faith. You know, a lot of people take that saved by grace a little too far. You know, I'm saved by grace, so it don't matter what I do. It doesn't matter what my life looks like. Well, I don't think the Bible teaches us that. What saved by grace means is we don't have to do anything for it. God gives us grace. God gives us salvation, but through faith. And that faith is an action word. That means we're going to live like we believe we're saved. That means we're going to live what the Gospels teach. That means we're going to be the servants that God wants us to be. And that's what James is talking about doing the works and the deeds and showing our faith by the things that we do. Even in Ephesians 2, when Paul's talking about being saved by grace, he said, we are saved and created to do the things that God had appointed for us before him. There are things we have to do that we're saved by grace through faith. Not like under the law, where it was so rigid. On the cross, Jesus took away our sins. The greatest gift we could ask for. One thing we couldn't do for ourselves was remove our sin. No matter how good we are, no matter how good of a servant we might be, no matter how much we love people, we still can't take away our sins without the blood of Jesus. And on the cross, Jesus took our sins. Every one of them. Took them away from us. Because Jesus was the perfect Lamb of God and the only worthy sacrifice for the sin of mankind. He was the only one that ever walked the earth that committed no sin. That was 100% guaranteed, dedicated to serving God with all of his life. He was the only one able to do it. And so that made him the only worthy sacrifice. And so he did. He took away our sins. You know, that was part of the Jewish tradition as well. The sin sacrifice had to be a perfect lamb. No flaws. Jesus had no flaws. The Hebrew writer says in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 28, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. He was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. Now, when it says many people there, it's not limiting to who was saved. And with this making a point, that he just wasn't there to save himself. He just wasn't there to save him and a few others. It was about all people. It was about all the world. The blood that Jesus shed on the cross became the blood of the sacrifice that purifies us. And anybody who accepts his teaching, anybody who believes and is baptized is washed in the blood. And that blood continues to flow yet to this day for anybody who wants forgiveness of their sins. And it continues to flow over us as Christians as we continue to go through this life and we continue to need forgiveness for things that we might do. The blood still flows. We are still forgiven. That happens on the cross. So it brings us to the question, what about the cross today? What about the cross today? Does it still have the same meaning? Well, the cross must be the focus of our preaching. Without the death of Jesus on the cross, we don't have reason for our faith. We don't have reason for our faith. As Paul was preaching in the city of Corinth, he kind of brought this point out. We have to understand the kind of city that Corinth was. Corinth was a port city. And it was full of depravity. They were pretty much accepting of anything. And about anything and everything that was in the world happened in Corinth. Because people from all over the world would come there to trade, to bank, to do whatever. And since it said on a major trade route, many people came there from other countries and they would come in and they would bring their customs and people in Corinth say, hey, that looks like fun. I think we'll get involved with that. We'll do that. And so Corinth became this city that was just full of all kinds of different religions, all kinds of different idolatry. And they were a very rich city. because the city sat on an isthmus between the two seas, instead of the ships having to go miles and miles around to the south to go around it, they would come up there and men would bring the ships and drag them across land to get them to the other side because it was quicker. But it was also very expensive. So Corinth made a lot of money doing that. And so Corinth was a city that was just full of evil, full of idolatry, full of total acceptance. In reality, it was a lot like society is today. Anything goes. If you think it's right, then it must be okay. But notice Paul's focus when he's preaching to Corinth. He says, "For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified." This verse, we all pretty much know. We've all heard it. But it's also one of those verses I think we don't study enough to get the full meaning out of it. That we know what it means on the surface, but we don't ever look deep. What Paul was saying here, I didn't come to you to teach you all these other different things. I didn't have to teach you about traditions. I didn't teach you about that. I taught you about Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Because that's the basis of our faith. And if we don't build a base, don't build a foundation, the rest of it's kind of senseless. And so Paul said, this is the foundation of Christianity. Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I didn't come to tell you all the things you're doing are wrong. I didn't come here to tell you that you have to do this, you have to do that. I'm just telling you, your foundation needs to start right here. And I think we need to learn that as Christians, especially when we're evangelizing, because someone who has been doing something for a long time, you're not going to get them to stop it overnight. You're just not.
Amen.
And so you build the foundation and give them something to build on. You work with them and you teach them and you help them mature. That's what the spiritual walk is all about. Learning and understanding the conversion process. And changing. And yeah, sometimes it's going to be slow. And sometimes it's going to be real slow for some people. But we just keep going. Because as the church, that's part of our responsibility to help one another come to that maturity. No matter how long it takes. Today, the cross is convicting. When people are confronted with the cross of Jesus, they have to make a decision. I mean, it's just that simple. When people are presented with Jesus Christ and Him crucified, they've got to make a decision. Am I going to be obedient? Am I going to walk away? And make no mistake, everybody makes the decision. They either choose to be obedient or they choose not to. Even if they say, well, not right now, they chose not to. And I'm not saying we leave them alone and never go there again, but they need to be reminded that a decision has to be made. Remember on the day of Pentecost, as Peter was preaching, and he preached to them about Jesus, he told them who Jesus was. He told them about their history. He told them about the crucifixion. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 37, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" You know, once Peter told them, this Jesus whom you crucified, God has made both Lord and Christ. And they were cut to the heart. They had to make a decision. And 3,000 of them did that day. They chose to be obedient to the gospel. It's not always an easy decision for people, especially for people who haven't honestly considered eternity. You know, so many people just live in the day, they don't consider their eternal soul. The Because so many people has taught them throughout different periods of their life, when you're done on this earth, you're done. It's over. And I always get kind of amused when people talk about that, when you try to bring them to Christ, and they say, well, what's the use? When I die, it's done. Well, wouldn't it still be better to live a life of love? To live a life where you're serving people, putting others first, and they're doing the same for you? So what? So what if we are wrong? Which I don't believe we are. But what if we are wrong? Then you've lived a great life. But if you're wrong, guess what? You've got an eternity of condemnation to face. So why take the risk? Why take the risk when you can insure yourself against that? But people don't always see it that way. They don't always think about it that way. And of course, there's other factors too. There's people who was raised in other religions, or maybe, you know, even pagan religions or what have you. And they don't want to condemn their family, so to speak. They don't want to turn their backs on people. And so it's a hard decision for them as well. But the cross is convicting, and people must make a choice. And finally, our cross must be carried. Our cross must be carried. Jesus made it very clear that cross bearing is a requirement for being his disciple. In Matthew chapter 10 and verse 38, he said, and if anyone who does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. And anyone who does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. So we have to bear our cross on a daily basis. And that cross we bear are the things that we suffer because we're Christians, because we choose to follow him. Remember, Jesus told his disciples, all men will hate you because of me. Well, we bear that cross when people don't like us because we're Christians. We bear that cross when we are persecuted for our faith. We bear that cross when we stand up for what's right and people stand against us, even if it's the majority. But we bear the cross and we continue on and we persevere and we follow Jesus just like he did. He didn't let the persecution get him down. He didn't turn away. Even when it came to the point of execution, he didn't back down. He followed the path that was laid out before him. And he followed it to the end. And we are saved. The cross is very important to we who are children of God. Because we look at the cross and it reminds us. Reminds us of the great love that our Father has for us. It represents the crucifixion of Jesus that took away our sins. And the cross must be the central theme in our preaching and teaching, because without the cross, the rest has no meaning. We can teach all about all the different traditions in the church, and we can teach about different things we do in the church, but without the foundation of the cross, it's going to crumble. So think about it tonight. What does the cross mean to you? What does it hold to you personally? Well, hopefully it does remind you of the great love of God and the fact that you're forgiven and the fact that that's what you should be teaching and talking about. Because the cross is that symbol that's very important in our life. If you're here tonight and you've never been baptized for remission of sins, Jesus died on that cross for you. And he's calling you to come and be baptized, to be immersed and come up out of the water with a brand new creation and have your sins forgiven. Christian, maybe you've been looking at the cross lately, and maybe you need to talk to God about that and have him open your mind a little bit. Respond to him and ask him to do that. Maybe you need to respond publicly for whatever reason, so that the church can pray for you. We'd be glad to do that as well. So take the opportunity to respond to God in some way, privately, publicly, as we stand.